Obviously, Sittadin Muslimin was created in a different time and for different kind of politics. How ably do you think you have been able to take the party forward?
Look, for a political party to remain relevant, it has to ensure that the present day challenges and objectives are met. And that is why a political party remains relevant, because people's hopes and aspirations are different from what they would be in 60s or 70s and 80s and 90s. So that is why we try to reflect the hopes and aspirations of the people. And I don't feel that it is something extraordinary thing which is great. But every political party does it. So, you know, with time, certain challenges are always there, will remain. But the aims and objectives and expansion has to be there.
But how successful do you think as a leader you have to be?
I cannot measure my own success. I don't know how successful I am. But one thing I can say is that I'm trying my best with all the sincerity I have, and always asking Allah to help me. That is the best I can do.
As you plan to expand beyond Deccan, what legacies would you want to showcase?
You want to die early? So, I don't know, you know.
What are the achievements of your party in Hyderabad to showcase to not?
You see, individually, I have no role to play in whatever success MIM has achieved or will achieve in the future, inshallah. And see, this is all the hard work which has been done by the then party elders nearly 56 years ago. And they had really done hard work at that time. They have worked more selfless, you know, in a very selfless way. And that is why whatever little success we have achieved is because of Allah's mercy and because of those party elders who had worked at that time. I mean, if we can expand our party, that would be good. That would be much better.
But when it comes to, say, identity assertion of the Muslims, Majlis no doubt has helped them in giving voice, representation. But when we see around, and when we see, say, for example, last year, Kishan Bagh riots, or the recent encounter killing in Ale, we don't see situation of Muslims, say, in Hyderabad, very different from other parts of the country, for that matter.
So when the Kishan Bagh incident happened, we were able to control the situation and ensuring that it doesn't get out of hand, because communal riots had taken place over there, if I'm not wrong, in 2000 as well, sometime in 2000. And that was totally uncalled for and unprovoked police firing. We have made a strong representation to the government. One of the lawyers has also filed a case. About Aler, you know, there has been protest meetings throughout Andhra Pradesh under the umbrella of Mustareka Majlis Amal, headed by Abdul Rahim Qureshi Khan. And we have gone to the people, exposed the police high-handedness, and people who feel that Aler is forgotten are completely wrong. You see, people's memories are not, will not forget Aler, and a verdict will be given by people against the government if they don't do justice the victims of Aler, because definitely they were facing criminal cases and the judgment would have come by now. So this was a high-handed behavior. And we also filed a case in the High Court, which is taking some time, but I'm sure that once it is heard in the AP High Court, there will be a forward movement on that.
Your critics often say that you do raise issues, but they are often limited to rhetorics, and you hardly follow them or lead them to logical conclusions.
You know, they should give me example of such things, and I can say whether it is right or wrong. If I have done anything on those lines, I will be the first person to accept, okay, I have done it. But they must give me a specific example instead of making a wide allegation. So I cannot really substantiate on that. But if they make a give a specific example of wherein I have not followed up by my words, then okay.
Like say, Kishan Bagh riots, 6-7 people have died.
No, Kishan Bagh riots.
What is the statement?
No, Kishan Bagh riots was followed up, and for the first time, the Ministry of Home Affairs guidelines were implemented in terms of ex gratia. Though ex gratia cannot bring back the life of those poor people who have been killed, but we went and met the governor. At that time, there was elections were over, but elected government had not yet taken over TRS. So the governor was still was running the state. And the cases are still pending, so that does not mean that we don't follow it up. We are definitely following it up.
Leave out security, even in matters where Muslim leaders should have some control, say for example the condition of park properties. We don't see much difference in, say, from Hyderabad to other
animals. Absolutely wrong. The reason, show me one state wherein WAF properties which were under the encroachment of the government have been returned back to the WAF board. It is because of MIM's constant representation and pressure that nearly 55 acres of land near the airport under Baba Sharfuddin Dargah Rahmatullah Alayh was returned by the administration of Vice Rajshekhar Reddy. That land is still vacant over there, and you can see it for yourself. We got the task force office, the police task force was had encroached upon a WAF property at Green Limbs. We got it vacated. Now the government, instead of taking proper procedure, have given it under road binding for metro. Akbar as an MLA has filed cases in the High Court against many WAF properties. The then state of Andhra Pradesh in Vizag under Isaak Shah Madni Rahmatullah Dargah, we were the ones who filed cases against the Hindujas, and that case is still there. And it is completely wrong to say that WAF properties, MIM has kept quiet. It's a baseless allegation. In fact, I have challenged everyone to show wherein we have not done it. These are clear-cut glaring examples of what MIM has done and still continuing to do to protect WAF properties.
If we move beyond Hyderabad, do you think in this era when NAMO politics has rendered in a way Muslim votes irrelevant in North, MIM's political prospect is rising through counter-polarization in a way?
This is, in a democracy, in a participative form of democracy, and in a country like India, which is a heterogeneous country, you require more political voices. What is wrong in that? And counter-polarization for what? Where is the counter-polarization? There has always been a polarization among the so-called upper caste majority community. The weaker sections like Dalits and Muslims have always stood by the secular voices and the secular parties. Now it is for these upper caste majoritarian community to show how secular they are. And Uttar Pradesh, you have given an example of North India, Uttar Pradesh. For the first time in the history of India, there is not even a single Muslim MP got elected from Uttar Pradesh. So who is responsible for that? And why is it that the political parties who claim to be secular and who call me a polarizing figure, I agree with their allegation for a while. But what have they done to ensure that the Muslims get elected? Muzaffarnagar riots have happened. You have this classic case of 10 Muslim women who went to Supreme Court who were raped. The Supreme Court told the state government, pursue their matter, give them security, and file charge sheets within a year. Nothing has happened so far. 2 years have passed since Muzaffarnagar has happened. So these are the things which which these parties should understand. And you see, I am sick and tired of this, that no, we must help the secular parties at what cost. It cannot be a one-way traffic.
You often say we are the Muslims are not coolie of
Yes, we are not. See, this is the burden which these political parties have imposed on us as on our weak shoulders. And I don't think so present-day Muslims are willing to carry this burden of this secularism. You know, alone we cannot carry it. Let this burden be shared by everyone. And let this responsibility, it has to be shared. You know, it cannot be that I share the burden and you get the whole benefit sort of my sharing the burden. So that cannot happen. This has to stop.
In context to counter-polarization, from Maharashtra to Bihar, often there have been allegations that there is some sort of understanding with the BJP. Digvijay Singh alleged this.
Digvijay Singh has made that baseless allegation. And I have sent him a notice to my lawyer. And if he does not apologize, then we will definitely file a criminal defamation against him.
So you deny it completely? There is.
No, you see, where is the proof? The proof is on the other side. That is, I didn't contest in Maharashtra parliament elections. Shiv Sena BJP won 42 seats. Was there some sort of a hidden understanding between the secular parties and BJP? Modi got 280 parliament seats. Was there some sort of understanding? I didn't contest Delhi. They lost. Jharkhand, Haryana, Jammu, Kashmir, I didn't contest. Still, BJP won. I didn't contest in Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan municipal elections. BJP won. Now, how is it that what right have these people got to blame me? In Bihar, left parties are contesting on a different platform. Why isn't this question being asked to them? Why isn't this question being asked to Samajwadi Party, whose topmost leader shared a dais with the three important leaders of Congress, JDU and RJD? This in itself clearly shows that they are insecure, and what I am saying is exposing them badly. And that is why they have stooped down to this level of making baseless allegations against me. When I was in UPA for 8 years, I was a holy cow. Because now we are not supporting them and opposing them for rightful reasons, for political empowerment of the Muslims, for justice for Muslims. And that is why we don't like it.
From Maharashtra assembly elections to recent Bangalore Municipal Corporation, MIM had mixed results. How do you assess your party's prospect from
the election? We have to fight elections. We are a political party, we are not an NGO. So elections, we'll win elections, we'll not win elections. That is the beauty of democracy. But unless and until you fight elections, how do you convey your message? And you talked about the Bengaluru municipal elections. Yes, I accept the verdict. But one must also see the high-handed behavior of the Congress government over there. I was not even allowed to hold a single public meeting despite being a registered party in the Karnataka State Election Commission. I was not even allowed to do a single padyatra in any of the wards. In fact, the hotel where I was staying, he was threatened. I took a furnished flat, that person was threatened. I wanted to hoist the national flag on 15th August. The police stopped me saying I must take a permission. Even to hoist the national flag on 15th August. Now these are all high-handed dictatorial steps which were taken. And I am sure that once assembly elections announced, I challenge the Congress party to stop me in this way which they have done during Bengaluru municipal elections. Because the Election Commission of India will not tolerate all this nonsense. The elections would be, I am sure, free and fair. And a political party can contest. So let us, you know, the story is yet to be said on Karnataka as far as MIM is concerned. We will contest in assembly elections and the true, the strength of MIM will be shown. But of course elections we will be contesting, win or lose, but we'll have to contest elections. It's not that, you know, we cannot contest elections because of fear of losing. You know, once we lose that fear of losing, we'll win. and Kanshiram, late Kanshiram used to say, which I liked his quote very much, pehla election harna, dusra harana, tisra jeetna. So this is what it is. So, you know, as far as I am concerned, I want to contest elections. And maybe, if not in my lifetime, maybe next generation or the third generation will reap the benefits. But you will have to have contest elections to ensure that people develop that mindset of getting out of this fear of these so-called secular parties. Of course, we'll oppose communalism. We are totally opposed to the ideology of RSS and BJP. But that does not mean that I should sit as a weeping boy or a scared small little girl that no, that cannot happen. We have to assert ourselves because democracy gives you that right of putting forward your views, and the best way is to participate in election.
In Karnataka and in Maharashtra, MIM work to building grassroots organizations, but we don't see similar efforts so much in North. Where are the MIMs regional leaders?
No. That is completely wrong. In Uttar Pradesh, if you go and see, and also in Calcutta, in West Bengal, even without any MLAs or myself going over there, the public meetings which are being held over there are fantastic. You know, we are getting good response over there. So, at grassroots level, yes, organization is being developed. And you are right, we'll have to develop more leaders. And leaders are not going to fall from sky or emerge from the ground or from something like that. But they'll have to be developed, they'll have to be nurtured, they'll have to be guided. And I'm sure this will happen, inshallah.
So far, MIM is largely OIC-centric party. How do you plan?
How is it OIC-centric party? This cannot be a one-man show. This is a collective effort of lakhs and thousands of people, and some of these people, I don't even know them by their names. I don't hold a magic wand. You know, this is a result of collective effort of lakhs and thousands of people who have worked day in, day out, who are still working, who are making duas in late in the night, getting up and praying the success of MIM. That is because of all the collective effort and collective leadership. We have, you know, whatever success we have achieved is because of that. It cannot be, and it will not be an individual centric or what you're saying. It's not that.
Don't mainly known as a Muslim party, MIM is indulging in an interesting politics of Jai Bhim, Jai Bhim. And recently in your constituency, a new flyover was inaugurated by Akbaruddin, which was Bhimrao Ambedkar, after Bhimrao Ambedkar. And it connects in a way symbolically one Muslim locality with Dalit locality. I passed through that flyover. Are you willing to forge alliance with some Dalit leaders or Dalit groups in North?
You see, more than the political alliance between MIM and the Dalit parties, I am of the firm opinion that on social issues, Muslim and Dalits must come together first. That is very important. Because the issues concerning the Muslims and Dalits are exactly the same. And in fact, the empirical data of exploitation or backwardness of Muslims is also the same. If you see, the dropout rate of Muslims and Dalits starts at the ages of 11. And from age of 13, it becomes more bad. There is no much difference between the unemployment ratio or even the kind of work which Muslims and Dalits do. The beef ban in Maharashtra has hurted both the communities. One was the Quraysh brotherhood was doing the meat business, and the Dalits were doing the leather business. Both have been hurted badly economically. So I feel that if we come together on social issues, definitely the political understanding will be created. And only time will tell what will happen as far as political alliance is concerned. I cannot say as of now. But we are trying our utmost best to ensure that Muslims and Dalits come together socially and politically.
There are rumors of some sort of alliance with BSP.
No, no, that, I don't know where these emerge from. You know, and then the elections are not at the near horizon. So when the elections will be held in 2017, that will be the right time to talk about it.
The question everyone is waiting, especially in North, because it is so much shrouded in suspicion and mystery. Is Majlis going to contest election in Bihar? The dates have already been announced.
Yeah, we have meeting tonight or tomorrow. We'll decide, inshallah.
Tomorrow you are going to decide. But after your Kishanganj rally in Bihar, especially among Muslim leaders, there is that again that fear. I am coming back to that question again, that this will be counterproductive and it will eventually help BJP.
The thing is that Nitish Kumar was the railway minister when Godhra happened. He still continued with the BJP government. He continued with the alliance in 2009 as well, parliament elections. So Nitish Kumar is fine with BJP. Nitish Kumar is not fine with Modi. Asaduddin Owaisi is saying that there is no difference between Modi and BJP. They are the same. In fact, there will be more. There are more Modis in the BJP's and RSS organization. Secondly, what is the minority budget in Bihar? Not Muslim ministry. There's a minority ministry. There are 18% Muslims. Then if you add some Buddhist and Christian, it will come around about 19-20%. It is only mere 299 crores. Did I stop them from increasing the budget? What is the socio-education indicators of Muslims in Bihar? I understand that the state has problems, but what about the weaker section amongst the society of Muslims and Dalits? What is the representation of Muslims in government employment? These are the questions which these people must answer. You know, it is very... I am honored by blaming me for each and everything. But what are these questions which are very pointed questions I'm raising? You are, please answer these questions. During Nitish tenure, Forbesganj riots happened. What has happened over there? You know, why didn't these leaders at least go and file a case which we have done in Kishanbagh or in Aler? We went to High Court, we had protest meetings with, you know, throughout. Why isn't a single protest meeting held? So now suddenly, you know, they talk all these issues and no. How did BJP win 30 parliament seats? Did I contest in Bihar? Why couldn't you stop them? And what happened in 15 years tenure of Lalu and Mrs. Rabri Devi? What was the improvement over there? So these are the questions which, and how many Muslim MPs are there, MLAs are there? How many Muslim candidates are given tickets? So this is what it is, you know, when these issues are there, it is wrong to point a finger at me because the four fingers are pointing at them.
Not the politician. When I talk to Muslim intellectuals, especially in Bihar and in North in general.
You see, the politics which is being done in Patna is the same in Delhi. So the less we talk about all these intellectuals who are based in Patna, they should come out and answer these questions which I have put. I know all those intellectuals and all those people who are very good sitting over there and talking in a very good intellectual language, but do they have answers to these questions? They should answer these questions first and show their intellectual honesty.
I'm also asking a different question. These people say that the issues Majlis raise, especially you raise, are pertinent issues. But in Hyderabad, Majlis invested in social sector also, like say opening hospitals, colleges. Does Majlis have similar plan for North? Are you planning to say start a branch of OSC hospital?
You see, Majlis has established all these institutes not overnight. They came up after a struggle of 20-25 years. After 20-25 years of political struggle, these institutes came up. We started our party, the new MIM, which had no relation whatsoever with the Razakars of that time. In 57, in 84 we started a medical and engineering college. Why not? If we can do it in here, why not over there? Give me a chance. Because if these people have failed to do anything, so I should get the opportunity of doing it. But please understand that, you know, no one has a magic wand. This requires a lot of political struggle, lot of hard work. And why not, if it can be done over here, it can be done everywhere. If you have sincerity and complete belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this will definitely happen.
We talked about Dalit leadership in Majlis. My last question, except for reserved seats in corporations.
No, Aurangabad, you go and see.
No, I'm not talking about Dalits. I'm not talking about Dalits. Except for reserved seats, women reserved seats I'm talking. We don't see many women leaders at like top leadership of the MIM.
That is true.
When you expand further, as you are planning to diversify, are we going to see more representation of women?
I accept that there is a need and a requirement to have more women faces. And that is why for the first time last year, we had established a women's wing of MIM party in Hyderabad for the Hyderabad city. And we'll do it. You're absolutely right. You know, I cannot ignore 50% of the population and expect that my party would expand. So definitely, we are trying our utmost best to have more women faces. As you rightly said, I accept that more has to be done. Definitely, we'll do it.
Thank you so much. Thank you.